before.
Frank Cottrell Bryce is returning to write for Doctor Who. In the Forest of the Night, in the Forest of the Shite, more like. That was the worst episode of Series 8. It was one of the worst episodes of New Who. And he's writing an episode about emojis. I am not looking forward to this. And neither are most of the fandom.
After.
Wow, that was actually quite a big surprise, really. Yeah, well done, Frank Cottrell Bryce. You pretty much surprised everybody. That was a great episode. On with the review.
This episode makes me go like this. Except when it makes you go like this. And right now, I'm feeling like this. But there will be times where I'll feel like this. So without further ado, smile. Keep smiling. Are you all smiling still? Good! Alright, let's begin properly. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Nick here, and welcome to my review of Doctor Who Series 10, Episode 2, Smile, or rather the Revisitation review. This episode is written by Frank Cottrell Bryce, who wrote the Series 8 episode In the Forest of the Night. And as you would have noticed in my 2017's sketch of this review, I didn't really think it was a very good story from that. I might have maybe overreacted a little bit, but I was kind of jumping on the hate In the Forest of the Night bandwagon. As of now, I might think In the Forest of the Night is one of the worst episodes of the revised series, but only by default, because there's so many good ones. And it's no longer the worst episode of Series 8, it's the second worst, because I disliked Kill the Moon more. So, yeah, so just above went up a little bit. But yeah, it's still pretty low down. Smile, on the other hand, is a bit more like how Frank Cottrell Bryce would write a great Doctor episode, but still has room for improvement. Not to mention plenty of nitpicks. So, to start, after a great first scene in the TARDIS between the Doctor, Bill and Nardole, where the Doctor tells Nardole he's taking the TARDIS up to the office, and then tells Bill he's taking her across time and space, we then have the second scene of the story and the second half of the pre-titles, and it's pretty interesting when we have scenes like this, where we have scenes with the TARDIS team first before we get the scene that starts off the story. So that's pretty interesting. In this case, a pair of women get killed by these robots called Vardis and the little emoji robots. The two women are shepherds for this planet, which is being developed for human colonists who are awaiting being awoken in inside their cryostasis pods. Fun fact, one of the shepherds is played by Mina Awe, who played Geeta Chandra in the Sarah Jane Adventures, mother of main character Rani Chandra, played by Angie Mahindra, who Series 12 viewers will know as the Skiffra Queen. And this is quite a shocking opening, actually, because when the Vardis kill the other woman, not Mina Awe's character, her sister, the character's sister, when they kill her, it's quite shocking that they all go around her when she's being sort of hugged by the smiley bro, the emoji bots. Let's call them the emoji bots. And then the body come down and turn her into a skeleton, which crashes onto the floor. It's quite shocking, and it's really well effectively done. This episode is the first episode of the series after this Christmas special to be given a 12 rating, and I think this scene alone kind of earned that 12 rating, even if later parts of the episode say it could be okay at PG. Although In the Forest of the Night was a PG, and I felt that that could be a U. Anyway, so a few days later, or however long time passes between then and the next scene, the Doctor and Bill arrive and start exploring, and it's a pretty great episode to show Bill exploring this, her first alien world, well, first alien world after what we saw in the pilot, and encountering a new robots and species and going to this this futuristic Earth building, which, funnily enough, is actually filmed in a real-life location in Spain. I have to say, the first half of this episode is really brilliant. It's just the Doctor and Bill going around this place, a couple of emoji bots, and they're just investigating some really great stuff as they're discovering about the what's there, and just exploring and getting to understand what's happening, and then discovering that all is not all as it seems. I also really like the way that Bill kind of realises why the TARDIS is disguised as a phone box, even though it's not disguised as a phone box because the Doctor goes around helping people. That's kind of what she understands it to be, that the Doctor is like this intergalactic policeman coming to save the day, helping out, etc. So I like how she kind of thinks that, even though that's not why the TARDIS is a police box or why the Doctor does that, he just passes through and helps out. But I like how Bill kind of puts two and two together and kind of makes a kind of a reasonable connection. And it's just really great to see the two characters explore and bond in the start of the teacher-student dynamic. And Bill starts learning more about the Doctor, like he's got two hearts. And yeah, they just have such a great rapport between each other. We also have some great visuals. The cinematography is great and the effects look really great as well, as per usual. When we get to the old spaceship in the middle, it's still handled really well, but it starts to dip a little bit more once the colonists get introduced and they're about to go and attack the emoji bots and the Vardi because they killed the shepherds. But it's pretty interesting to explain why they did that in the first place, because they didn't understand grief and they didn't know about it and they didn't really comprehend it. So they thought it was some sort of a virus that they had to kill out, and people being happy was what was important, but they didn't understand other emotions. So that's an interesting idea and it works really well. I also like, this might be an unintentional connection, but I like how the first person who passed away on the colonist, the way that they're on the bed, kind of gives me flashbacks to the pirate planet, where with the queen on the bed. It's not done exactly the same as that, but I like how it's not unintentionally similar. It just reminds me a lot of the pirate planet. It's quite interesting. It's the very final couple of minutes where the episode kind of falls down a little bit, where the colonists decide to go and try attacking the Vardi, even though the Doctor and Bill are trying to understand. So the Doctor has to basically press the reset button to sort it out. Now the time with the story of the Magic Haddock, now that makes a bit of sense and it's quite nice. And it's also, once again, showing Frank Cottrell Boyce taking inspiration from children's stories, like within the Forest of Night, for this adventure. But it's where I have my kind of issues with, to be honest, considering the first scene in the TARDIS with the Doctor, Bill and Nardole, and then with the end, that final scene, which ties into the next episode, I wouldn't be surprised if this climax was slightly rushed in editing. But to be honest, on a script level, it feels like it was rushed in the first place anyway. So I feel like we should have had a little bit longer with the climax. Basically, what the Doctor does is he just resets everything. The Vardi forget everything about the humans, and they have to start putting stuff behind them, and the humans paying rent or something, as the Vardi turn out to be an intelligent species, as they consider themselves under attack. And so, yeah, basically the Doctor just resets everything. I feel like we could have had a slightly better climax than that, and a slightly better resolution. Maybe the humans, instead of going to attack them, maybe they could go and talk to the Vardi and try to understand them. Maybe the Doctor could help them introduce other emotions into them, instead of just restarting them or resetting them. Maybe he could have helped them understand other emotions, and then the humans would also, they're still upset, they're still cross, but they're gonna try and help the Vardi. But no, we're gonna have humans pissed off, so they go and try to kill the Vardi, which understandably makes sense, but we've done this type of story so many times. We need stories more like the understanding ones, where they realize, okay, yeah, we're upset, but we're gonna try and do what the Doctor says this time, because he seems like the smartest person in the room. For once, can we actually have a story like that once in a while? I mean, sometimes we have, but for once in a while, can we have that type of story? And also the whole reset button feels like a bit of a cop-out. I also have the nitpick that the Doctor uses sonic screwdriver in this episode way too much, and this has already been an issue with many people throughout the series, and it's going to continue to be an issue over the next couple of years as well. But people were saying the 13th Doctor uses her sonic screwdriver too much in Series 11. this episode, Smile the 12th Doctor uses the sonic screwdriver on stuff that could easily have had a button or something. It just feels like he's getting it out too much. And yeah, it's useful what it's supposed to be useful, but I feel like maybe, like with the skulls in the compost machine thing, maybe there's a button. You can always just use a button sometimes. And this also ties in with the whole reset thing with the sonic screwdriver. Now, fair enough, the sonic screwdriver could help them sort out a few circuits and tie into what I was saying about maybe they could have changed the Vali to understand other emotions. But the whole reset thing... But I will say... That I am glad that the Doctor doesn't use the sonic screwdriver to knock out an emoji robot coming to attack him in the engine room. He instead uses a wrench, which is really cool. Just whacks it on the little robot. That's pretty cool. Other nitpicks. The colonists are bland, and like I said, they just go to once the Doctor tells them stuff, they go to arms and they just do angry reacting human stuff. And they're still kind of reacting angry humans afterwards. Ralph Little does a good job as the main colonist we see, but they don't really do an awful lot in the story. They're just basically there to be the colonists, and that's it. God, I never thought I'd be giving Colony in Space credit, but they at least had distinguishable characters, and they did stuff. Not much more to say about this episode, apart from the fact that the emoji bots, whilst it seems like a very 2017-y or 2010s, 2020s thing, and it's probably an episode that will probably be a bit dated in the future, like how Bad Wolf was with the game show stuff. But that being said, it is still a pretty interesting idea, and the idea of emojis does kind of have a universal language, like pictures. Not everyone can read each other's language. So, like with Lego and IKEA, they use pictures rather than words. So, yeah, emojis instead of words. That's a good idea, and it ties in really well with the story, with the emotions of the characters. So, yeah, this actually is a pretty good idea. Yeah, the emojis might become a bit dated in the future, and it might also be riding off the Emoji Movie, although that wasn't a very popular movie. I haven't seen it yet, but it's not very popular at all. But it's still a pretty interesting idea for this story. Yes, again, with the game show stuff in Bad Wolf, it's a pretty interesting stuff for the story and for the time. It works pretty effectively, even though we thought it was going to be a flop. It was going to fail so hard, especially as it was written by the guy who wrote In the Forest of the Night. But no, it's actually a pretty good idea, and this is a pretty good episode, a really great episode. In fact, that first half alone has the potential to be one of the best of at least Series 10. But it kind of goes downhill just after the halfway mark, late towards the end, and then the climax is kind of very disappointing. So I will be giving Smile a well-deserved but could honestly have been better, and it looked like it was going to be 8 out of 10. Yeah, I say it could have been better because that first half actually has the potential to be a 10 or at least a 9. And even when we get into the engine room, it's still looking like 9-10 territory. It's just when we get into that final act is where it kind of drops into more disappointing territory. So overall, we get ourselves an 8. Although it is a close 9, I'll give it this. I probably could be close to giving it a 9, but it does have its little issues, and the ending is a massive cop-out, and isn't very good. It's a bit of a disappointing ending. It doesn't go as disappointing as, say, Love and Monsters or Closing Time or The Wedding with a Song. Those stories were really let down by that ending. So is this one, but I think there was enough in this episode to keep it pretty strong. Whilst those other episodes did have some pretty strong elements in the good parts, I think this episode has some really great stuff going for it that, with the disappointing climax, didn't quite damage it as much as those other examples. This might be a controversial opinion, considering those episodes aren't very popular. And this one, it kind of gets a bit more of a positive reception than maybe we were expecting, and B, those other episodes I mentioned. But I don't think it's like considered an all-time great or anything, but I think it is considered like one maybe people enjoy sometimes. Maybe they'll stick it on and just enjoy it. It's a good one to stick on just to have some fun. If you want a Capaldi episode that doesn't have Clara and you just want something fun, enjoyable to watch, then put this one on. It's a good one. And so that's Smile. Thank you for watching this revisitation review. Next time, as the end of this episode shows, we will be going to London during 1814, so Regency London during the Georgian times, and we will be visiting the final Frost Fair in Series 10, Episode 3, Thin Ice. I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye. Don't forget to click below to subscribe to the Nicholas Payne YouTube channel.